get any response. Good morning.
As it's still morning for Anurag.
Ma'am, one more class is left for MEG 1.
Okay, all the other subjects.
All the others are completed.
Okay, fine. So this is our first session, and we will have, as you know, we'll have five sessions for this month, and maybe five for the next month. If possible, I'll be finishing all the portions within 8 or 9 sessions itself, because as you know, there are 9 textbooks. Did you get the textbooks?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, have you gone through the textbook? Are you using soft copy or do you have hard copies with you?
Hard copy, ma'am.
Hard copy, okay, then fine. Some of you might be using soft copy. It's fine, we can use it, no problem. Only thing is that some of you find it comfortable when you have a hard copy. But because some others find it difficult to read the letters in computer. So it's okay if you have a soft copy, no problem. Anyway, we have 9 textbooks, as you know. First one is, if you can recall, first textbook is titled, What is Language? Second is titled, The History of English Language. Then third and fourth, we have English Phonetics, Phonetics 1 and Phonetics 2. Then we have Morphology. Then we have Syntax. It's not clear. Is it not clear? Shaila says it's not clear.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
I don't know why it is. Okay. Let me try to be more clear. Okay. So we have 9 textbooks in total. You have an attendance form to fill. Sound was low. Is it okay now? Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we have 9 textbooks in total. First one is titled, What is Language? Thereby we will see the different theories regarding language, what is language. There are some definitions given about language. Then we have structuralism and transformational generative grammar. These are the portions that are dealt in the first book. Then coming to second book, it is history of language. So I hope many of you have taken English as your degree subject. Isn't it so?
Yes.
No, ma'am.
Okay. Even
yes, ma'am.
It's fine. So I just want to know. That's why I asked. See, we have 9 textbooks in total. First textbook is about the history, language. Definitions about language are given. Along with that, we have some theories regarding language. Theories means structuralist theories and transformationist theories regarding language. Then in the second textbook, we will come across the different periods of the development of English language, Old English, Middle English, and Modern English. Then the third textbook starts with phonetics. There are 2 parts to the third module, that is phonetics part 1 and phonetics part 2. After that, we will see morphology. Then we will see syntax. After syntax, we have 2 textbooks with the same title, Language in Use 1 and Language in Use 2. That I won't deal in the class because they are very easy to understand. If you go through it, you will understand what it is. It's just like you're reading an essay. It's that simple. Then after that, there is the spread of English. That textbook is also very easy. Those who have read it will understand. It's really easy. Then the last textbook is stylistics. That we will deal in the class. So we will first start with phonetics, because some of you have come from English background, and some of you don't know what is phonetics and phonology. So we'll start with phonetics and phonology, because if you don't understand what is phonetics or the symbols related to phonetics, transcription symbols related to phonetics, when I take the theories regarding language, you won't understand it. So I thought of starting with phonetics. Am I clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So let's start the presentation. I have prepared some presentations, but I haven't prepared presentation for all the textbooks. Rather, I'll start with the phonetics presentation that I have. For others, I'll take some parts of the textbook and I'll show you. You also have the textbook, so if If you want, you can also keep the textbooks with you.
Okay.
Okay. So we'll start with, shall I get into the chapter?
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So let me take the textbook. See, is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
So I'm starting with block 3. As I told you,
sharing the slides with us.
Yeah, I am sharing the slides with you, PPT.
Thank you, ma'am.
See, the reason why I started with block 3 is that in first block, we will come across certain terms like allophones, allomorphs and all. So only when you understand what are allophones and allomorphs, that I'll be able to explain it when we take the first block. So that is why I thought of starting with block 3, phonetics and phonology. This is a basic level thing. So once we finish it, we'll move on to morphology. So the basic sound system or the study on speech sounds are called phonetics. Once we finish phonetics, we'll move on to morphology. It is the study of meanings, or rather meaningful words. Then we will deal with syntax, that is the study of the structure of English language. So once I finish phonetics and morphology, we will go back to first block. That is what is language. Okay. So moving on. Phonetics. That is the branch of, as you know, it is a branch of linguistics that deals with the study of speech sounds. So we'll have a question. Why do we study the speech sounds? So there is a specific reason. And also, the block is
your voice is breaking. Can't
again,
hear
is anything. It is it breaking? Is it same for all?
No.
All of you find my voice is breaking?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. Maybe it's because of your net connection. Anyway, phonetics is the study of speech sounds that deals with the study of it is a branch of linguistics. Linguistics is the study of language. So this phonetics is the branch of linguistics which deals with the study of speech sounds. Then there is one more title, that is phonetics and phonology. That is how our text is titled. Phonology is again, it almost means the same. It deals with the systems of sound. But the only thing is that we can compare the one system of sounds of a particular language with another language. That is what we deal in phonology. Phonetics is something that deals with only the speech sounds. But when it comes to phonology, we may compare the system of sound with another language. We may compare the system of sounds of a particular language with another language. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Moving on. Then this is the question that I asked. Why do we study phonetics? Why we study phonetics? Again, most of the Indian languages are phonetic in nature. That means we speak the language as we write it. Right? Is it so? We pronounce the words as we write it, or we speak the words as we write it. But when it comes to English, there is no one-to-one correspondence between how we write and how we pronounce it. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
This is a common fact. This is something which is known to everyone, which you all know. I have given certain examples to show the difference. See, look at the first set of words. Fat, fate, father, above, machine. So there are five words which all use a particular vowel as common. Which is the common vowel in all the five words? A is common in all the five words. But look at the pronunciation of A. In the first word, fat, we have that A sound as in man, can, fan. But look at the second one. Again, we have a vowel A there, but the pronunciation has changed. Here it is A, not A sound. So we have fate as A, as in fate, mate, date. So we have an A sound for the letter A, or as we call it A, father. Again, we have a different pronunciation for the same vowel sound, for the same letter A, father. It's the long R sound. Right, father, farm, dance, and castle. Castle is actually castle in American, and dance is dance in American. Dance is British, while dance is American. Many say it as dance. It's actually dance for British. So father, it's a long R sound. Again, look at the fourth word, above. See, we have a different, or we have an inverted E letter, that means that that has to be pronounced as a, as in above, again, another. That is not a, that is not a, that is not even a sound, rather it is an a sound, above, again, another. So we have a different sound for the letter, for the same letter A in above. Check the last word, that is a machine. Again, we have the same A letter, but the pronunciation is not inverted a, rather it is the normal A, machine, A sound, right? Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
So, yes. From this you understood that we can have different sounds for the same letter. Then look at the second set of words. See, agree, achieve, receive, police. Do you find anything common and anything different? What is different?
Two vowels together.
Yeah,
two vowels together.
Two vowels. And the last, look at the last word. It is just a single vowel, that is I. But in all other four words, we have a combination of two vowels. But if you analyze it, you can see that all those vowel vowel combinations and the single vowel has got the same pronunciation E, right? See, agree, achieve, receive, even though they have got different vowels or vowel combinations, we have the same pronunciation, that is the long vowel E. See, agree, isn't how we pronounce these words? See, agree, achieve, receive, police. So we have the prolonged E version for all these vowel combinations and the single vowel sound I, receive, achieve. So from this we understood that sometimes different letters can have the same pronunciation. Different letter combinations can have the same pronunciation, and the same letter can have different pronunciations. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
I hope now you understood why we study phonetics, why we study the speech sounds. Because once you study the speech sounds, at least you will understand how the words can be pronounced. What is the right pronunciation of these words? But for that, we need to know the transcription symbols. Otherwise, we won't understand. So when you Google certain words and all, you will see that the transcription is given below the word, the meaning of the word, so that we will know the correct pronunciation. That is to guide us to the correct pronunciation. Otherwise, if you teach a child how to pronounce these words, the child definitely will get confused, because definitely the child will ask you why all these words have the same vowel sound and different pronunciation. Why is it so? Then we can tell him that this is an unphonetic language. This is quite unlike our language, because there is no connection between how we write and how we pronounce English. I hope this idea is clear, why we study phonetics.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Moving on.
See, so yes, for the sake of pronunciation, we study 44 phonemes. Again, the description or definition of phoneme is given there. A phoneme is the smallest sound unit. So we study vowel sounds, vowel combinations, consonants, all under phonemes. The name phoneme. So English has altogether 44 phonemes, which can be divided into 20 vowels and 24 consonants. So how many vowels do we know already?
Five.
There are only five sounds. Only five sounds. How do we pronounce those five vowels?
A E I O U.
Ah, I wanted to hear that. A E I O U. Is it actually you?
No.
It is actually O. That is why we don't use an in front of university. We don't say an university. If it is a vowel sound, we could have used an, but we can't use an in front of university, youth, because it is ya sound. Ya is a consonant sound. It is a common misconception that U is pronounced as U. It's actually wrong. So we have to pronounce it as U, A-E-I-O-U. This is how we are taught. Because from when we were children, that our teacher taught us that there are five vowels that are to be pronounced as A-E-I-O-U. But that U is actually a consonant sound. Am I clear? Is my voice
clear? Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So there are 20 vowel sounds and 24 consonant sounds. And again, we are going to break the 20 vowel sounds further as 12 monophthongs and 8 diphthongs. So we know that there are 5 vowels, but under phonetics, we study 20 vowels, which are again subdivided into 12 monophthongs and 8 diphthongs. We will see which are the 12 monophthongs and which all are the 8 diphthongs. So before getting into the transcription, we will first see the mechanism of speech, organs of speech. I hope you have heard of these systems: respiratory system, phonatory system, and articulatory system. So they are called the organs of speech. They are not meant only for the production of speech. Respiratory system has got other functions, phonatory system and everything has got other functions, but still, for the sake of understanding the organs of speech, we have classified them as respiratory system, phonatory system, and articulatory system. Now let's see what is the respiratory system. A respiratory system consists of lungs, the muscles. As you can see the picture, respiratory system consists of lungs, which almost come towards the. It's not clear in the picture. Can't be seen in the picture. It comprises the lungs, the muscles of the chest, and windpipe or trachea. Windpipe and trachea, these words are common nowadays due to COVID and all. Windpipe or trachea, the passage. You can see the windpipe. This is the windpipe. The pipe-like structure which goes down. Okay, so this is all about the respiratory system. Under respiratory system, we should know the different types of airstream. Airstream refers to the movement of the air as it is pushed out of the lungs. Airstream is the movement of air as it is pushed out of the lungs. So we have three types of airstream mechanism going on. First one is pulmonic airstream. Second is glottalic airstream. Third one is velaric airstream. Okay, pulmonic, glottalic, and velaric. So pulmonic airstream is the air is pushed out. The air pushed out of the lungs is used. It is called the pulmonic airstream mechanism. So here, air from the lungs initiates the airstream. So that means when we breathe in and when we breathe out, the air is pushed out of the lungs. Then this stream of the air is used for speech production. It is called the pulmonic aggressive airstream mechanism. Aggressive means when the air is pushed out of the lungs, and when it is used for the production of speech sound, it is termed as pulmonic aggressive airstream mechanism. Don't forget the term, but we all use pulmonic aggressive airstream mechanism. The air which is pushed out of the lungs is used for the production of speech sound. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, the phonatory system. Phonatory system, so we have seen the respiratory system. Now we will see the phonatory system. Again, it consists of larynx. It is also known as Adam's apple. If you touch your throat, you can feel it. Larynx, Adam's apple, something which is projected out of your throat. It is more visible in the case of men, Adam's apple. So again, it consists of something called the vocal cords. It's a pair of bands. It is placed horizontally from front to back, which is joined at the front but you can see that it is separated at the back. And the space between these two joints are called the glottis. The space between these two joints is called the glottis. Let's see the picture. This is vocal cords. So you can see that the front part is attached to the second part. The back part, there is a space between the two vocal cords. That space is known as, what is that space known as?
Glottis.
It can be held together or it can be kept apart. So that is what I have written. The vocal cords can be held wide apart. So when it is kept apart, when it is held apart, you can see that the air passes freely without any obstruction. So but sometimes this cords, the vocal cords are held close so that when the air enters, it kind of makes a friction so that vocal cords vibrate. Okay?
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
So when the air passes without making the vocal cords vibrate, they are called the voiceless sounds. So when the glottis is held close or when the glottis is closed, then the air passes with some friction. As a result of this friction, the vocal cords vibrate. Air that's produced or the sounds that's produced are called the voiced sounds.
Punyati!
What is happening? So vocal cords can be held close and can be held open. So when they are in this position, the pressure of the lungs make them vibrate. So air, the sound produced or the air produced when the vocal cords vibrate are called voiced sounds, and the sounds produced when the vocal cords do not vibrate are called voiceless sounds. Is that clear?
Yes.
To certain sounds, the vocal cords do not vibrate. They are called voiceless sounds. But when you produce certain sounds...
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Please explain with an example.
I'm going to give an example. When you produce voiced sounds means when you produce vowels. Try to produce certain vowels. A, you can feel the vibration in your throat. Or else we can take the example of B, D, G. When you produce these sounds, these consonant sounds, B, D, G, if you touch your throat, you can feel that your vocal cords are vibrating. Try to produce these sounds. So they are voiced sounds. Because why they are called the voiced sounds? Because
there is a vibration.
The pressure of the air make the vocal cords vibrate. They are called the voiced sounds. All the vowel sounds are voiced sounds. All the vowel sounds. We have seen there are 20 vowels and all those 20 vowels are voiced sounds. There are a few voiced sounds. All the others are consonant sounds. We'll see that. Okay. Then we are coming to the articulatory system. We have so far discussed the respiratory system. Then the phonatory system. Phonatory system mainly comprises the larynx. Larynx has got something called the vocal cords. And there we have also seen the classification of sounds as voiced and voiceless sounds. Now we are moving on to the last important system, that is the articulatory system. Articulatory system, if you can recall the picture, the pharynx, the lips, teeth, pharynx, I'll show you the picture again. Pharynx, can you see the picture of pharynx? Pharynx, this is pharynx. This pharynx, this is larynx, and coming up, you can see pharynx. Can you see pharynx? Then lips, teeth, all the other parts of our mouth, the lips, the teeth ridge, hard palate, soft palate, the uvula, the tongue. Tongue can again be divided as tip, blade, front and back. I'll tell you what is hard palate and what is soft palate. So I hope you have understood what is pharynx, the passage that just connect the mouth to the vocal cords, not the vocal cords, the larynx, that is the pharynx. Then we have the lips, the upper lip and lower lip. Then we have the teeth, the upper row of teeth and the lower row of teeth. Then we have the teeth ridge. So the teeth ridge, the hard palate and the soft palate constitute the roof of the mouth. Okay, the uvula again. So the tongue is the lower part of our mouth, which can be divided as tip, blade, front and back. So a hard palate is the part teeth, I hope you know what is the upper row of teeth. Then just behind that, you can feel a hard part that is closely attached to the teeth. That part is called the teeth ridge, alveolar ridge. It's also called the alveolar ridge. If you can feel with your tongue, you can see that the flesh that is attached to the teeth, the upper row of teeth, it is the teeth ridge. Clear?
Clear, ma'am.
Just behind that, you can feel a hard part, a hard concave part, that is the hard palate. Just behind the hard ridge, just after the, next to the teeth ridge, lies the hard palate. Then we have the soft palate, the soft part, the roof of the mouth, which is soft and fleshy. That is the soft palate. Behind the hard palate, next to the hard palate, there is a soft and fleshy part of our roof of the mouth, which lies opposite to the tongue, which is very soft, which is very fleshy. That part is the soft palate. It is also called velum. So it is also called velar palate, or soft palate, or velum. So teeth ridge has got another name, alveolar ridge. Soft palate is also called velum, V-E-L-U-M, velum. Then uvula is a soft soft part which is hanging towards the end of our tongue, the part which hangs, the fleshy part, that is the uvula. Then we can divide the tongue, the tip. As you can see, it is a tip of the tongue. Then just after that, we have the blade of the tongue. Front part is the part which lies opposite to the hard palate, and back part is the part which lies opposite to the soft palate. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Moving on, what there's a term called the passive and active articulators. So active and passive means, as the name suggests, passive means the organs of speech which remain passive, that cannot move. But active articulators are those articulators which move during the production of speech sounds, which can move, are called active. In the case of lip, which part of the lip that moves? Upper or lower lip?
Lower lip.
Lower. Again, lower of teeth, tongue, they all move. They all are called active articulators. But passive articulators do not move. Instead, the active articulators move towards passive articulators. Or off teeth, teeth ridge, hard palate. But soft palate can be both active and passive. In case of certain nasal sound, soft palate can be lowered so that air passes through nose. That we will discuss later. So soft palate can be both active and passive. Sometimes it remains active and sometimes it remains passive. Especially when you produce nasal sound, it comes down. So soft palate belongs to both categories. So what is the, how can we classify vowels and consonants? That is the next question. We call certain sounds as vowels and certain sounds as consonants. So in case of our spoken English, we may classify vowels and consonants based on the articles that comes before it. So we say that an is used to before vowel sounds and a is to be used to before consonant sound. That is the only difference that we know, right?
Yeah.
So now we are going to see the actual difference. In case of vowels, there is no obstruction for the airstream. So the airstream from the lungs is unobstructed so that it goes out without any obstruction. So the oral, this obstruction doesn't happen in the oral passage, because vocal cords, in the vocal cords there is already an obstruction. When it comes to the oral passage, it is unobstructed. Air passes through the oral passage without any obstruction. So sound produced when the oral passage is unobstructed are called vowels. Is the idea clear? But in the production of consonant sound, there will be some kind of obstruction in the oral passage. Either sometimes the obstruction will be made using the lips, sometimes it is using the teeth, sometimes tongue. One or the other kind of obstruction will be there, or friction will be there, so that air passes with a audible friction. Sounds thus produced are called the consonants. This is the difference between, this is how we differentiate vowels from consonants. Vowels are produced without any obstruction. Again, don't forget that vowels are produced without any obstruction in the oral passage. While in case of consonants, there is obstruction in the oral passage. Don't take the case of vocal cords because that is another system. That is phonatory system. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we will deal with the consonant sounds, then we will move on to the vowel sounds. So there are three tame labeling for consonants. There are three tame labeling for vowels as well. But in the case of consonants, this classification is clear. But in the case of vowels, it's very subtle so that we don't understand. We don't often find the difference at all. The difference is very minute. But in case of consonant, it is very clear. So first classification is based on the vibration of vocal cords. So already we have seen that there are two types of sounds, voiceless sounds and voiced sounds. This classification is not applicable to vowel sounds. Why? The first classification is not applicable to vowel sounds.
No obstruction in oral passage.
Look at the first difference. Exactly, they are all voiced sounds. All vowels are voiced sounds. So this particular, the first classification is not applicable there, because here what matters is the vibration of vocal cords. I have told you that some consonants are voiced while some others are voiceless. So this first classification comes only in the case of consonant sounds. Then second is the point or place of articulation. Which is the point of obstruction? That is the second classification. Where does this obstruction happen? How does this obstruction happen as the third classification, that is the manner of articulation. How is it articulated? How this particular consonant sound is articulated? How, where, and based on the vibration of vocal cords. These are the three classification, the three tame labeling of consonants. First is based on the vibration of vocal cords. Second is based on where, or which is the point of articulation, and third one is how that is articulated, how the consonant sound is articulated. Again, here in English, we follow pulmonic aggressive airstream mechanism. Don't forget that. What is aggressive mechanism? Pulmonic aggressive airstream.
Pushed out of the lungs.
The air pushed out of the lungs is used. So when the air pushed in is used for the production of sound, it is called ingressive airstream mechanism. Ingressive. It is very rare. I've heard that Sindhi language uses this ingressive airstream mechanism. So most of the Indian languages use pulmonic aggressive airstream mechanism, along with many European languages like French, English, Italian. All these languages use pulmonic aggressive airstream mechanism. So first, there are only 9 voiceless consonants in English. All the rest are
voiced sounds.
Vocal cords vibrate during the production. So there are only 9. So when you produce these sounds, pa, ta, ka, I have written an example so that you will understand. CH combination is to be pronounced as ch. Right? We often use the pronunciation ch to read ch combination, right? Or ch combination is often pronounced as ch in most of the cases, but there are other pronunciation as well. In case of chauffeur, we use sh sound for the combination ch. In shaft also we use ch. Am I clear? But the usual pronunciation of ch is ch. Even though we have other pronunciations as well. That is why I gave you the example of chauffeur. In the word chauffeur, C-H-A-U-F-F-E-U-R, C-H-A-F-F-E-U-R, in that word or C-H-A-F-F, chaff, we have C-H combination, but the pronunciation is sh.
Okay.
So ch as in cheese. See, look at the symbol that is used. Don't forget the symbol. That symbol is to be, next time when you see that symbol, you should read it as ch. So, because there are two letters involved, so we have a simple symbol to represent the combination, that is ch. It is a simple symbol. when there are two images involved, it is actually a single symbol, cha. Then next is fa, that we use the same letter as the symbol. Then we have next one is again something new. I think you are familiar with the symbol, the transcription symbol, theta.
Yes.
The theta symbol will be used for the pronunciation of TH combination because there are two pronunciations for the same TH. Yes. Which are they? TH can be pronounced in two different ways.
The
and the TH. In there, we pronounce it as the, there, this. But in certain words, thin, Thames, the river thick. Thames, thick. In all these words, we use the as a pronunciation. So we have, in order to avoid the confusion, we will use two symbols. One for the and the other for the. So here, the is a voiceless sound. The is a voiceless sound that we will see later. The is a voiceless sound, thin. See, when you produce thin, vocal cords do not vibrate. Similarly, when you produce pa, ta, ka, cha, fa, ta, all these sounds, you can feel that, you can see that our vocal cords do not vibrate. Air passes without any friction in the vocal cords. So next is sa sound. Again, it's a very familiar sound. There is no separate symbol for it. Sa's letter is used. Then again, we have a new symbol. That is SH combination. You see that?
Yeah.
So we got rid of that ch from ch, so we got ch. It's a curved kind of line. A curve at the front and back. So that's a curved kind of line that is to be used to represent the sound ch, as in shoe, shame, because we have two letters to represent the same sound. So we will, from now onward, we will use a new symbol, that is sh. Next is, last one is, please read the sound, her. It is her. We don't ta, ka, because pa, when you say pa, it's actually a combination of pa plus a. So there is a, always say it as pa, ta, ka, then ch, p, and t, s, sh, and h. Okay, these are the nine voiceless consonants.
Is it sir or
sir. No, sir. It is sir. Sir. Same. Okay. Not s. So how can you produce a word using that sound? Z. It is sir.
Snake.
Again, it is snake.
S.
It's a combination of sir and n. The consonant cluster, so we will pronounce it as sneak. And same, we use sir plus a sound, it's a vowel, so it is to be pronounced as sir. We have z sound is there, we have z sound, but that we will see later. So these are the nine voiceless consonants in English: p, t, k, ch, f, t, s, ch, and h. Clear? So this is based on the first classification, whether voiced or voiceless. So there are nine voiceless sounds in English, voiceless consonants in English, all the rest are. So how many voiced consonants will, how many are the voiced consonants? How many consonants are there in total?
24.
Among them, nine are
voiceless consonants.
So how many will be the
15.
So there are 15 voiced consonants in English. Next classification is the point or place, based on the point or place of articulation. So look at the divisions. There are nine divisions. First one is bilabial. As the name suggests, bilabial. Two lips are involved.
Two.
So the point of articulation is the lips. So we have the lower lip and we have the upper lip. So the passage, the airstream will be closed using the lips. The obstruction will be made using the lips. The lower lip is the active articulator. As you have already seen, lower lip is always the active articulator, while the upper lip is the passive articulator. When you produce these sounds, p, b, m, then w, it is w sound, lips round. So when you pronounce the sound wa, your lips take a round shape. Okay. Don't make your lower lip touch your upper row of teeth. It is V. It is for the letter V. That is wa sound. So when you produce, when you pronounce wa for W, it is with round lips. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So P, B, M, and V. When you produce these consonants, you can see that the lips are, the two lips are involved. That is why they are called the bilabial sounds. The next one is labiodental. Again, lips and dental means?
Teeth.
Teeth. So the lower lip is the active articulator, while upper of teeth is the active articulator. So the sounds F and V. When you produce, that is why I have told you already, when you produce W, the sound for W, it is V. It is a bilabial sound, while V is a labiodental sound. So when you produce the sound V, when you pronounce the sound V, you can see that your lower lip touches the upper of teeth. So it is called a labiodental. Okay. Then dental. Next is dental sound. So we have already seen the symbol for ta, that is a theta symbol. Next is the. The, if you can see that, it's like an anchor like symbol. This. This. A curvy figure with a horizontal line. Did you see that?
Yes, ma'am.
So dental sound means active articulator is the tip of the tongue. You just produce those two sounds, thin and this. You can see that the tip of the tongue touches the upper of teeth. So we get the and the sound. So we call these two sounds as dental sounds. So we have already got two classification for the. The is a voiceless dental sound. Is it clear? While the is a voiced dental sound. Similarly, P is a voiceless bilabial sound. B is a voiced bilabial sound. Did you understand the classification?
Yes, ma'am.
And what is alveolar? I have already given you the meaning of alveolar. Alveolar refers to
teeth ridge.
Teeth ridge. So ridge. The active articulator here is the tongue and passive articulator is the teeth ridge. Look at the sounds t, d, l, n, s. See, even when you pronounce the sound, also check the point of articulation. You can see that in all these, in the pronunciation of all these sounds, you can see that your tongue touches the teeth ridge. T, d, l, teeth ridge is the part which lies next to the upper row of teeth. Next is the post-alveolar sound. Here, the active articulator is again the tip of the tongue, but while the passive articulator is neither teeth ridge nor the heart palate. That is the part in between teeth ridge and heart palate. Can't be rightly called a teeth ridge, nor it can be called a heart palate. So it's a part in between teeth ridge and heart palate. So that is a rare part of the teeth ridge. We have only one post alveolar sound in English, that is R. Then next is palatoalveolar sound. Again, the active articulator is the blade of the tongue. Didn't I tell you what is the blade of the tongue? The part which lies next to the part which comes just behind the tip of the tongue. Blade of the tongue. So here we can see that the blade of the tongue moves towards teeth ridge. Along with that, the front of the tongue, which is the part which lies opposite to the front of the tongue. Didn't I tell you that? A heart palate. The part which lies opposite to the back of the tongue is the soft palate. In the case of palatoalveolar sound, two movements are taking place simultaneously. One is the blade of the tongue move towards teeth ridge. Along with that, the front of the tongue moves towards the
heart palate.
So we have the sounds ch as in chain, j as in juice, sh as in shame, sh. Can you see that symbol, tree-like symbol?
Yes, ma'am.
It is a new symbol again for us. It is to be pronounced as ja. Yeah. No, it is neither ra nor sha. In between sha and ra. In Malayalam, we have a sound ya, mara. But this is not that ya. It is ja plus ra. Ja plus ra is
it's major. How the French pronounce
ja. It's kind of French.
Jean Piaget.
Again, Rona. In all these words, you use ra. That is measure. Correct. Jean Piaget. It's kind of French uses it more. Ja, measure, pleasure, vision. In all these words, we have the sound ja. But we here, we say it as, we often replace the ja sound with sha, measure. Then pleasure, it's actually measure. Then pleasure. But in the case of pressure, it is sha. Pressure uses sha, while pleasure uses ja. In shame, we have already seen the symbol for sha. Then juice. Do you see that? It's again a new symbol for us, juice. The three, B3, maybe B plus three combination. It is to be pronounced as juice. From now on, we will use D3 as a symbol for J. It is juice. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, ch, j, sh, and r. All these four sounds are palatal alveolar. Next one is palatal sound. Palatal here, palatal, the active articulator is the front of the tongue, while passive articulator is the hard palate. I told you already that the part which is opposite to the front of the tongue is the hard palate. Here, the front of the tongue moves towards the hard palate. We have only one palatal sound in English. Again, look at the symbol. J symbol is to be used for a sound. J is a symbol which has to be used for ear sound.
Ear sound.
Don't get confused between J and ear. Okay. It is to be that ear. From now on, we will use J as the symbol. Next is the velar sound. Again, active articulator velar. As I told you, what is velum? That is a soft palate. So here, the back of the tongue moves towards the soft palate. That is velum. So we have three velar sounds in English. First one is k. It's a voiceless sound. It's again a velar sound. Then g. Then we have
ng sound.
Ng sound. I am happy that you read it. Ng. It is ng. See, usually we use ng combination to represent the sound ng. From now on, we have a combination that we can say that n with a twisted t. That is a symbol for ng. It is sing, young. Okay, sing, young, language, English. In all these words, we use ng sound. So it will be represented using this new symbol, ng. Ng with a twisted t, ng. So last one is glottal sound. Here the active articulator, there is only one glottal sound in English, it is H. Here the articulators, usually the articulators come in the oral passage or articulator system, but here the articulators are the vocal cords. So H is the sound which comes from the vocal cords. So H is the only glottal sound in English. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
So these are the 9 classification based on the point or place. Shall I move on?
Okay. Yeah, ma'am.
Next is the manner of articulation. Manner of articulation, I told you already how it is produced. Based on this, we have classification. Plosives, affricates, fricatives, nasals, laterals, and approximants. Okay. Let us first take the case of plosives. So, as the name suggests, when you produce certain sound, it is produced with the plosion, explosion, explosive sound. They are called the plosive. So, in a simple way, we can say that there is complete closure and a sudden release of air. So, when we discuss the definition of consonant, we have mentioned that we have. I told you that consonants are the sound are the sounds during the production of which there will be an obstruction in the oral passage of air. Here, there will be complete closure of the active and passive articulator so that when they are open, there will be a sudden release of air. When the active articulator is suddenly removed from the passive articulator, the air passes with a friction. So sounds that's produced are called plosives. So you look at these sounds, p, b, t, d, k, g. When you produce these sounds, you can see that a small explosive sound is heard. That is due to the friction. Because the active articulator is suddenly removed from the passive articulator. So that air passes with some friction. So sounds that's produced are called the plosives. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Next is affricate. Affricate means there is complete closure as in the case of plosives, but the active articulator is not suddenly removed, while it is slowly released. It is slowly removed from the passive articulator, but still there will be some friction. So sounds as produced are called the affricates. Complete closure by slow release of air. In the case of plosives, there is a sudden release of air, but in the case of affricates, there is a slow release of air. Examples are ch and j. Now onward, I hope you will read the symbols for me. Fricatives. Fricatives means close approximation. Close approximation refers to active articulator is very close to the passive articulator. So there is a narrow space for the air to go out. So sounds is produced are called fricatives. Clear?
Yeah.
The active articulator will be very close to the passive articulator so that there will be narrow space for the air to go out. So sounds is produced are called the fricatives. Close approximation means approximity, very close, closeness. So the affricators in English are f, v, t, d, a. You may read.
A, v, t, v, d, t, d, r, s, r, z,
y, h.
Yeah.
Sh, yeah, very good. Next is nasals. I think I have told you that sometimes this soft palate is lowered so that the oral passage will be closed. So air from the lungs will then pass through the nose. So there will be complete closure of oral passage of air so that air passes through the nose. The sounds that's produced are called nasals. Which one are the nasal sounds in English? So these three are nasal sounds in English. Now we have a lateral sound. Again, we can see when you produce the sound la, you can see that the tip of the tongue makes a firm contact with the roof of the mouth, but the sides of the tongue are lowered so that air passes through the side. Sound that's produced is called the lateral. That is because there is only one lateral sound. It is L. Is that clear? When you produce a sound L, you can see that the tip of the tongue makes a firm contact with the roof of the mouth, but the sides are lowered so that air passes through the two sides. Okay.
Okay.
L is the only lateral sound in English. Next, we have approximants. Approximants are sounds with open approximation. Approximation means the active articulator will be close to the passive articulator. They're very close. But here, open approximation means there will be more space than in the case of fricatives. So the active articulator moves towards passive articulator, but there is sufficient gap for the air to go out. So that is approximants. Open approximation refers to the space. The space will be more than that in the case of fricatives. There will be more space than in the case of fricatives. Active articulator will move towards the passive articulator, but still there will be enough, sufficient space for the air to, but it won't be completely open, but still there will be some kind of friction. Sounds as produced are called approximants. There are two types of approximants. One is the frictionless continuant. There is only one frictionless continuant, that is R sound. Then we have semi-vowels also. Semi-vowels means ear and V. They act like vowels because when you produce ear and V, there is least friction. They act like vowels.
Ma'am, can you...
Okay. Yeah,
repeat. Can you repeat approximants?
approximant means there will be open approximation. In case of fricatives, I told you that there is close approximation. Close approximation means active articulator will be very close to the passive articulator. There will be very narrow space. Won't completely obstruct the passage of the air, but there will be very narrow space for the air to escape. But in the case of approximants, there will be open approximation. Active articulator will move towards passive articulator, but there will be sufficient space. The space won't be as narrow as in the case of fricatives. There will be some more space so that the air escapes freely without much obstruction. We can say that much obstruction. We can't say that without any obstruction, but rather we can say that without much obstruction. The air passes without much obstruction. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Approximants. One is the frictionless continuant R. See, as the name suggests, frictionless, less friction. Then next are semi-vowels. Why they are called semi-vowels is that they act like vowels because there won't be much friction at all. Vowels are produced without any obstruction. Just like that, in case of were and were, you can see that there won't be, there will be negligible friction. So again, one more case is there, because when you produce ear sound, you can see that it moves from E to ear. So it begins with a vowel sound. Again, when you produce wa, oo, it begins with another vowel sound, oo. So they are called semi-vowels. There are two reasons. Is the idea clear, manner of articulation?
Yes, ma'am.
So, same labeling of consonants. So based on the vocal vibration of vocal cords. Second is based on the place or point of articulation. Third is based on the manner of articulation. So look at the table. This table I have taken from your textbook. See, plosive. If you look at the table, you can now give the three-tame labeling. So if you take the case of T, can you see that T?
Yes, ma'am.
Alveolar. So how would you label T? It is a voiceless. VL refers to voiceless sound. It is a voiceless alveolar plosive. Voiceless alveolar plosive. So voiceless refers to the vibration of vocal cords. Alveolar refers to the place or point of articulation. Plosive refers to the manner of articulation.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Yeah, you may.
Ma'am, some students were not able to join, so they were asking if you will be sharing this PPT in the WhatsApp group.
Of course, I can send the PPT to one of you. I don't think I am in your group. Am I in your group?
I don't know, ma'am. I am also not in that group. They are from RC Cochin people.
RC Cochin. Sorry.
Mostly PPT are shared in RC Cochin. In fact, MEG2 and MEG3 PPT has been shared in RC Cochin group.
Someone is saying you are in the group.
If I am in the group, definitely I'll share you this all, the whole PPT I'll share.
Because my last batch,
I was there in the group so that I could share my PPTs with them.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. If I'm in the group, definitely I'll, if you have my number, if you are there in the group, you can personally text me so that I can identify the group, because I'm in so many groups. I don't know which group is what.
Okay, ma'am. I'll tell them to text you.
Okay, fine. Then I'll send you the PPT today itself. I'll share the PPT. Why they are not able to join?
Maybe because there's limit. Only 100 people can join in one class.
Okay. Anyway, we'll continue. Anyway, I'll share the. Don't worry. I'll share the PPT. So if you take T. So we will classify it as voiceless alveolar plosive. Now you may say, how can we classify J sound? How would we classify J sound? J. Yeah. Yeah.
Ma'am, can you please repeat that?
Ja. How would you classify
alveolar fricative?
Very good. Voice the palato-alveolar fricative. I hope now you understood the classification, 3TM labeling of all the 24 consonants. There are 6 plosives, 2 affricates, 3 nasals, 9 fricatives and 3 approximants. One lateral sound. Approximants can again be subdivided as frictionless continuant and semi-vowel. So we have 3 approximants. That's how we get 3 approximants. Is the idea clear? Shall I move on?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, there is a very important thing, allophone. Allophone is the aspirated sound. So it's a variant of a phoneme. Phoneme is the smallest distinctive sound. Smallest sound is termed as phoneme. Smallest distinctive sound is the phoneme. So it's a variant of the same phoneme. It's called an allophone. So that is an aspirated sound. For example, when you pronounce certain words, like for example, when you say pen, pig, then Peter, you aspirate the P sound, don't you? Because that is a stressed sound, P. So you may say it as Peter, you call it as Peter or Tom. So that is an aspirated sound. So it is the allophone of the sound P. It's an aspirated version. So different variation of the same sound is the allophone. Is that clear? Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am. Can you explain once more?
Yes. Okay. For example, when you say per, when you pronounce per in the initial position in certain words like Peter, pig, pen, pan, you give an extra force to the sound because that is the stressed sound there. Peter, pen. We don't usually pronounce in that way, but when you listen to the pronunciation of the native speakers, you can say that they give aspiration. Tom, Thomas, that is how they pronounce it. That is the aspirate. That is a different variation, different sound variation of the same sound.
So there is a stress, ma'am?
Yes, because that part is stress. That is why we give an aspiration.
Okay.
But in certain cases, for example, police, we don't say it as police, it is police. There we use a normal per sound. Spell, spin, in all those words, we use the normal per sound because it is not the stressed word there, because there is one sound which precedes it, sir sound.
So only initial sounds are stressed?
Most often stressed sounds are
initial.
Sounds have this allophones.
Okay.
So allophone, in order to show allophones, we use a slanting line. And again, if you can see that there is an H which is given about that is to show the aspiration. H denotes aspiration. So when you transcribe the word Tom, you might see that the slanting line is used to represent the allophonic variation, that is ter, and we will also see an H about that is to show that we use the aspirated version of ter here, that is Tom. 10. Is it clear? So in order to show aspiration, in order to show an allophone, you use that T with a description H. Clear?
Ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Once more, you want me to explain another example?
Ma'am, not clear.
Allophone means it is the sound variation of the same phoneme. It's a different sound variation of the same phoneme.
Okay,
the sound will remain the same, but there will be a small variation of the sound. So, for example, when you pronounce certain words, when you use the sound T in the beginning of certain words like Tom, Ten, Thomas, you give an extra force to the letter T or sound T. Tom, Ten.
Okay.
So, but sometimes when you use it in the middle or end of a sentence, spit. There also we have used ter sound, but we don't aspirate it. We don't say it as spit. Because it comes at the end of a word. It is not aspirated because it is not the stressed sound there. Most often this is associated with stress. Most often this aspiration is associated with stress. Because that time, in order to give an extra force, we aspirate the sound. So that time we use H about the word, so that about the sound, so that we can show the aspiration. This is an aspirated version of the same sound is being used. Clear?
Okay, ma'am. Clear. Yes, ma'am.
So based on the position, based sometimes when in the initial position, it can be stressed. So that time we can use an allophonic variation. So that time we use allophone. That doesn't mean that whenever per comes in the initial position, it has to be aspirated. That is why I gave you the example of police. In the case of police, we don't aspirate per sound because stress doesn't fall on per. It falls on the second syllable, that is la. So we say it is police, not police.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Is the idea clear?
Yeah, ma'am.
Not
yeah,
to show aspiration, use H above the letter so that we can show the aspiration. It is a variant. It is a variant of the same sound. This is allophone. Now moving on. See, I have taken an example from your textbook. Per. See, these are the cases whereby we aspirate per sound. Per is aspirated when it occurs initially and in an accented syllable. Accented syllable means stressed syllable. For example, pool, pole. Again, look at the second, third word, appear. Appear, in that word, per doesn't come in the initial position. It comes in the second position, but still it is aspirated. Why? Because it is an accented syllable. Accented means it is where we put stress. Appear. We don't say it is appear. We rather say it as appear. So there also we use the aspirated per. Appear, play, a point. Again, a point. Per. See, that comes in the second position. It is a second syllable. Still, we use aspiration just because it is the stressed syllable.
Okay, ma'am.
So, per can be aspirated when comes in the initial position as well as in the accented position.
Accented
position means the stressed position. But per is unaspirated when it occurs in unaccented syllable. Sometimes it comes in the initial position, but it is not aspirated, as I have told you earlier. See, because prevent, in the word prevent, per comes in the initial position, still it is not aspirated, just because in that particular word, the second syllable is stressed. Prevent, prevent. It is not prevent, it is prevent. So we don't aspirate the per sound. Similarly, sometimes it is preceded by, I told you this example, spell. Spy, speech, it is not aspirated because it is preceded by a spiral S. Again, it occurs medially in a syllable as in opt, kept, lapse. Again, it doesn't come in the accented position, comes in the middle position, it is not aspirated. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Again, per is inaudibly released or released without. Sometimes we don't even hear that per at all, without explosion. We produce per without any explosion at all. It occurs when it occurs finally. Silence, as in cap, step. See, so there per, the sound per is very low. Again, it occurs before another plosive or affricate. So it has got another plosive which precedes it also. It is released without explosion. It is inaudibly released. The sound would be very low. The pronunciation would not be clear at all. Kept, wrapped. So again, the per sound is very negligible. So keep checking. So in all these words, we can see that it is another affricate or plosive precedes it. Ker is another plosive, right? Ker is another plosive. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So in all these words, it is inaudibly released. So these are the allophones. Again, per is nasally released. That is, air passes out through the nasal passage. When it is followed by O, as in stoop most, stoop me, in all those words, we can see that it is preceded by O sound. So we will have a nasal release of the sound per. So these are the different variants of per sound. As in order to show aspiration, we use H sound. But there are different allophones for per. Sometimes per is used with aspiration. Sometimes it is inaudibly released. Sometimes it is released through nose. Is the idea clear?
Yeah, ma'am.
These are all different variations of the same sound. Per. In Malayalam also, we have na pronunciation, na pronunciation, na.
Na.
Na. Ah. Mm-hmm. So just like that, these are the different allophones of the same letter na. Just like that, English has also got allophones for the same sounds. I've taken only one example. If you look at your textbook, you can see the allophones of almost all the consonant sounds. There they have given you the allophones of all the consonant sounds. I have taken only one example. Okay, shall I move on?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now we will see the syllable. I was mentioning the term syllable in order to tell you about the aspirated sound. So what is a syllable? Syllable means the unit which is higher than the phoneme. So syllable doesn't mean that it is a consonant or it is a vowel. It's a unit distinct from a phoneme. It is the next higher unit than a phoneme. And it is very important in order to, it is very important for the correct pronunciation. So just understand that syllable is the next higher unit than a.
Is it breaking the words into small, small parts?
Yeah, it's kind of. It's how we break a word into small, small parts. It can consist of a vowel. It can consist of a consonant, but there will always be a vowel sound. We can divide a word only if there are vowels in it. So based on the number of vowels, the number of syllables will also increase. That is why I've told you that this is the next higher unit than a phoneme. Phoneme means it is the smallest distinctive unit. But syllable can have a combination of two sounds. Can be a combination of a consonant vowel, or it will be a combination of many consonants plus one vowel. But the only rule is that there should be a vowel in it. So we can say that vowels are the nucleus of a syllable. Is the idea clear? For example,
yes,
if you take the example of police, how many syllables are there? Police. Police.
Two.
Police. So there are two syllables in it.
Two syllables.
Per means it's a combination of per and the vowel per. So it's a syllable. It is not just a single sound. There are two sounds involved. That's why I said that it is the higher unit than a phoneme. And look at the second syllable, police, L-I-S. So there are three sounds involved. La, the consonant, E, the vowel, and S, another consonant. So in the first syllable, we got two sounds. And in the second syllable, we got three sounds. Doesn't matter how many consonants are there. What matters is the number of vowels. The more the number of vowels, the more will be the number of syllables.
Okay.
You will see that. So division of word into a syllable. So a word can consist of one or more than one syllable. In order to be a word, there would be at least one syllable in it. But there are certain certain letters which can act like words and which can be called a syllable. For example, a man. When you say a man, A is just a letter, if you take letter A as a letter. But if you take it as an article, it's a word, right?
Ma'am.
Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
So it's a syllable. It's also a word. Sometimes a syllable can be a word. Again, division of words into syllable. A word can consist of one or more than one syllable. Then look at the words. You can see that the number of syllables depend on the number of vowels. Except, look at the word. In order to understand the number of syllables, we have to first transcribe the word. I hope you understood what is transcription. In transcription, you use the symbols to transcribe a word. Transcribe means you use the symbols to give the correct pronunciation, to get the correct pronunciation.
Yeah.
Okay, now check the words. Except, how do you pronounce except? So you don't check the vowels. You just understand that it has got two syllables. Accept. So if you simply divide it, you will get one C along the first syllable, another C along the second syllable. But if you transcribe it, the syllable division will be easier. Accept. So look at the pronunciation. Accept. Afford. Again, in the first syllable, we have only one vowel sound. Then second syllable, we have three sounds. Two consonant sounds along with one vowel sound, right?
Yeah.
So accommodate, how many syllables are there? Accommodate. I haven't divided the word. Accommodate.
Four syllables.
There are four syllables. Accommodate. So examination, how many syllables are there? Examination.
Five syllables.
Five syllables are there. Civilization. Cultivation.
All five.
Cultivation.
Four syllables.
There are only syllable. Four syllables. Cultivation four has syllable. Got only four syllables. This is how you divide a word into syllables. So in order to understand the correct...
Teacher.
Okay. Yes.
Told that accommodate, there is four syllables.
Accommodation.
Four syllables.
That's accommodation has got five syllables. Accommodate has
not accommodate. Accommodation.
Accommodation
has got five syllables, while accommodate has got four syllables.
Means at last there comes a E, right?
Even then, so it is not pronounced.
That's not
counted. Haven't you studied Chaucer's Canterbury Tales?
No.
See, most of the lines end with the letter E. That time, in old English, we used to pronounce the ending E and all. But now, we don't pronounce it anymore.
No, it's not pronounced.
We have still maintained the pronunciation, but we have maintained the spelling, but we don't pronounce those words. That is why we have T-H-E-R-E, W-I-F-E. In old English, we used to pronounce it as wife. But now we don't pronounce it. Just because we have, even though we have kept the spelling, we haven't kept the pronunciation. That is the reason. So that is why in many words, we have the ending vowel, E as the ending vowel, but we don't pronounce it. I've told you that in phonetics, we are only concerned with the pronunciation. Don't look at the spelling. That is why we are studying phonetics.
Yeah, and phonetics. English is an unphonetic.
English is unphonetic. We have nothing to do with the spelling. Even though spelling is important in writing.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Is that how silent letters came about? Because it's there in the spelling and it's not pronounced?
Yes. Most often. In borrowed words also, there are certain letters which were pronounced by the foreign language speakers, but later when we borrowed it, we didn't keep the pronunciation. There are many reasons. This is one of the reasons. In Old English, we used to pronounce it. It used to be phonetic. It used to be phonetic. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. That also we will study in block 2, the history of language. Then you will understand it better. So allocate, in all these words, we can see that those words end with E, allocate, commute, but we don't pronounce it. That is why when you divide the word into syllables, that is why I told you to transcribe the word first so that you will see that it is not pronounced. See, when you transcribe the word, you won't get that E. Look at the words allocate, allocate, allocate. Even though the spelling has got E, when you transcribe it, there is no E at all because it is not pronounced.
Okay, ma'am.
Is the idea clear?
Yeah.
Yes,
ma'am. I'll give you the word strength. How many syllables
teach
are there?
One more thing.
Okay,
for
ask
a person who haven't heard this pronunciation, how will he differ it?
There is no way. You have to study the transcriptions, phonetic symbols. There is no other way other than studying the phonetic symbols.
Someone who have to pronounce it or analyze it in correct way should have to hear.
Of course, if you want to really study the pronunciation of correct pronunciation, you have to be native speaker. They don't need to study the pronunciation because that's how they are grown. And they are exposed to the correct pronunciation, so they don't need to learn it. So if you are not a native speaker, if you're a second language learner, you have to study the transcription. You have to study the phonetic symbols.
Okay, thank you, Rema.
Then, if you know the symbols, you can check the pronunciation. You can use a dictionary. You can use some web sources or some books to understand the correct pronunciation.
Ma'am, can you suggest some materials or book for this transcription or some?
Then there are so many transcription books available. Or just Google it. You'll get Oxford Dictionary, Cambridge Dictionary. All the dictionaries are there. If you simply write a word and meaning, for example, examination meaning, or define examination, you will get the pronunciation along with that. You'll get the meaning along with the pronunciation given under the word. Have you ever checked it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. That is how you... Then Daniel Jones Dictionary, Pronouncing Dictionary is there. It is very good. Daniel Jones Pronouncing Dictionary. English Pronouncing Dictionary. That also you can buy. Because see, make sure that you are following our received pronunciation RP. RP is the standard English of British. If you're following American English, you may have to use some other books, because CNN and all, some books, because Americans have got another standard English. Their language, their standard English is different from that of American English, that of British English. That's why I told you an example earlier. Dance for British, it is dance, while for Americans, it is dance. Then advertisement and advertisement, both the pronunciations are there. Advertisement is British, while advertisement is American. Laboratory, laboratory. Laboratory is American, while laboratory is British. There are so many differences. If you are someone who always watches English movies, Hollywood movies, you will be exposed to this American pronunciation. Then that time when you listen to British pronunciation, you might find it a bit difficult, because they have got a different pronunciation. Just like we have different dialects in our language. For example, if you are speaking Hindi, you will have different variations, dialectical variations. You have this Hindi, that Hindi, and so on. In Malayalam, we have different dialectical variations, like Tiruvananthapuram Malayalam, Kozhikode Malayalam, Kasaragod Malayalam, and so on. Just like that.
Slang.
But we have a standard form for English, that is standardized Malayalam. That is what we use for official purposes. Just like we have a standard in Hindi. Even though other variations are also there, we follow a standard Malayalam, we follow a standard Hindi. Just like that, we follow an Indian standard English accent, we have a standard American accent, we have a standard British accent. See, our textbooks are based on British English, that is RP, received pronunciation. That is what we are studying. So all these transcriptions are based on RP. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Shall I move?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Then the structure of the syllable. See, structure of the syllable, as I told you, that sometimes a word, vowel can make a syllable, as in the case of then we have ear, air, in all those words, ear, air, and all, we'll see that there is only a single vowel. It doesn't have any consonant at all. Air, air. Do we have a consonant sound in that? Air?
No.
Even though we write an R, we don't pronounce it, right? Because whenever you use an R, if it is not followed by a vowel, it should not be pronounced. So the sound R can be pronounced only if it is followed by a vowel. In all other cases, R is left unpronounced. That is why we don't pronounce R in heart, girl, pearl, coat. In all these words, we don't pronounce R sound, just because it is not followed by a vowel sound. But in the vowel case sound. Of prank, in all those words, we pronounce R sound just because it is followed by vowel sound. This is my car. There we don't pronounce R sound, but Americans say it is car. R sound they use. But for British, they don't pronounce R. They would say it as this is my car. They don't pronounce R sound. While when they make another sentence like this car is mine, there they can use, there they pronounce R sound because it is followed by E sound. This car is mine. My father is a doctor. There, in that case, you can say that you can pronounce R sound because it is followed by a vowel sound, S. But when you say that this is my father, there you don't pronounce R sound because it ends with a R sound. It is not followed by a vowel. We have so many words which end with R sound, but which are all unpronounced. Father, mother, sister, brother. In all those words, we don't pronounce R sound. Is ID clear?
Yes.
Okay. So vowel is the nucleus of the syllable, because you can make a syllable with a single, with a vowel in it, but you can't have a syllable with a consonant. See, what about the word strength? I think I have given you the word strength. How many syllables are there in the word strength? S-T-R-E-N-G-T-H, strength.
One syllable, ma'am.
Is there any other syllable? That's a monosyllabic word. Monosyllabic means there's only one syllable. Trisyllabic means there are two syllables. Trisyllabic, or we can say the polysyllabic words. If there are more than two syllables, we call them polysyllabic words. if a word begins with a most often we will have consonants in a word. Okay, so sometimes we will have a releasing consonant, sometimes we have arresting consonants. Releasing consonants means words ending with a vowel sound. Arresting consonant means we will have a word ending with a consonant sound. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, types of the syllable. You can see that. Syllable type, this also I have taken from your textbook. Syllable type. V means there is only one vowel. Okay, that syllable consists of a vowel, consists only of a single vowel. So I, A, I, ear. Now there are four words. All these are words. I, A for the article A. Then I, ear. All these words have got a single vowel in it. Doesn't have any, they do not have any consonants. So these words are made up of a single syllable, which is a vowel. Then VC means a word consists of a vowel plus a consonant. Then third category, that is CV, means we have a consonant which precedes a vowel. Then we have CVC, that means a vowel is preceded and succeeded by a consonant. CCV, vowel is preceded by two consonants. Examples are also given. Is it clear? Am I clear?
Yeah.
Stay, sky, play, cry, small. In all those words, we can see that, take the example cry. So we can see that k, r, both are consonant sounds, and I is a diphthong sound that I will tell you later, but it's a vowel sound. So we have two consonants which ends with a vowel, that is I. Again, C, 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 V, that means there are three consonants which precede a vowel. Then we have C, 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 V, C, that means three a vowel preceded by three consonants and succeeded by a consonant. Is the idea clear? Do I need to explain?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, C, 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 V, C, C, that means vowel preceded by three consonants and succeeded by two consonants. Example, screeched, strained, stalled, sprint. Take the word sprint. Sprint, there is only one vowel in it, E sound. And before that E sound, we have three consonant sounds, S, P, R. Then we have two consonants. A consonant cluster, na and t, after the E sound. So we get the combination CCCVCC. Okay.
Okay.
Is it enough? Shall I move on to the next slide?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
So we have initial and final consonant clusters. Cluster means, again, it's a combination of two consonant sounds. Cluster means combination of cluster. As you know, cluster means a group of something. So consonant cluster means a group of consonants. So two consonant clusters means spin. It's a cluster of two consonant sounds, p, s, and p. It's, there are two consonant sounds. So it's a cluster of two consonant sounds. Pray, in the word pray, we have got a cluster of two sounds. While thwart, the word thwart, again, thwart. Cluster of how many consonant sounds? Twa. Twa is a cluster of, exactly.
Excuse me, ma'am. Can you please repeat the last word that you said after pray? What was that word?
Pray, twat. T-H-W-A-R-T.
Two consonants, ma'am.
Ah, there are two consonants. Even though the spelling has got T-H and W, there are only two consonant sounds. The, as you have seen the symbol th, theta, then wa sound, twa. So it's a cluster of two consonant sounds. Moving on, we can see that initial three consonant clusters. Initial three consonant cluster means the word will have three consonant sounds in the initial position. Spleen, splatter, sprain, spurious, stress, stew, student. Again, look at the word stew. How would you get three consonant sounds in the initial position?
It's pronounced U.
That is why we get, okay. I told you earlier that year is actually a consonant, it's not a vowel.
Okay.
Okay, stew. So we that is how we get three consonants down. Then student, again, student. Again, yeah, student. It is not yeah, it is not o, it is yeah, student. When though we see u or u letter as a spelling, the pronunciation is student. It is yeah sound. That is a consonant sound. There is only one vowel in it. That's why I told you to transcribe the word first. Otherwise, you will take the first u as a vowel and you will get two syllables, student. Okay. It is actually, there is that U sound is there, but along with that, there is one more vowel sound, one more consonant sound, ear sound. So it's a cluster of three consonant sounds, st, s, t, and ear. After that, we have a vowel sound, U, but still before that U, there is a consonant as well. Is that clear?
Yes. Ma'am, so do you consider this as a single syllable or a bisyllable?
It's a bisyllabic word. I was telling you that, see, there are three consonant sound which precedes that U. Even though we see it as S and T, there is one more consonant sound which precedes that U sound.
Okay. Okay.
Student. It is student. Similarly, it is stupid. It is not stupid. See, if you don't know the correct pronunciation, we would naturally pronounce the word as stupid. But actually, there is a ya sound, a consonant sound before that U. So we will pronounce it as stupid. It is the correct pronunciation is stupid, not stupid. So it's a cluster of three consonant sounds.
Consonant sound.
Okay. Now moving on to final two consonant clusters. Now earlier we were seeing the initial clusters which come in the initial position. Now we will see clusters that form the final position. Stopped, wept, depth. See, stopped. Usually we pronounce it as stopped, but it is actually stopped. There is a reason which I'll tell you later. Because words ending with a and the are sometimes pronounced as t, p and t, sometimes pronounced as id, stopped. But we can't say stopped here because p is a voiceless sound. So if a word, if ed is used after a voiceless sound, it has to be pronounced as p, t. But if it is attended, that is d sound. Okay, sorry.
Can you please just repeat what you said?
Usually we use ed to make the past form of a word, right? Past tense form of a word. We make it by adding e and d, ed combination.
Right.
Stop. The past form of stop is stopped. But sometimes, for example, dance, danced. There also we use ed to you need to make the past form of dance. But there we pronounce it as danced, not danced. But here, even though the same ed is used, the pronunciation is pant, stopped. It is not stopped. The reason is that, I was telling you the reason. Sound. Per is a voiceless sound. So whenever you use a voiceless sound, it has to be followed by another voiceless sound. Per t is another voiceless sound. Okay?
Ma'am, how does learn L-E-A-R-N-E-D or L-E-A-R-N-T?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Ma'am, how about learned? L-E-A-R-N-E-T.
Learned.
Or L-E-A-R-N-T.
See, learned. It is not the spelling which matters. It is the pronunciation. Learned. It is t and n and d. It is a voiceless sound.
Okay, in both the cases?
See, if you are pronouncing learned, the pronunciation is, in the case of t, when you make the learned, the word t, you pronounce it the way it is, the word as it is, learned, because the spelling has got t in it. But if you're using a past form using ed, then what matters is the word which ends the basic form. So if the basic form is learned and the past form is ned, you can use both forms, learned and learned, l-e-a-r-n-t. So if you are using t in the spelling, you also pronounce it as learned. But if you are using N-E-D, then you have to pronounce it as learned because there N is a voiced sound. So you have to pronounce it as D.
Okay.
If the spelling is T, then you can pronounce it as T. But if you are making an E-D combination to convert a word into a past form, then this is the rule. If the word ends with a voiceless sound, the pronunciation is T. And if the word ends with a voiced sound, the pronunciation is id. Id. I plus D. Id. Is the idea clear?
Yes.
Only in the case of ED combination. You mentioned T is in the spelling. If the spelling is T, then you can pronounce it as learnt.
So we are dealing with ED.
ED.
Okay.
Past form. These are this is called allomorphic variations. I'll tell you that later. Earlier we saw allophones. So this is about allomorphic. These points come under allomorphic variations. So different variations of the same morpheme that we will tell later. We will discuss. I didn't want to confuse you, but I just said it. Leave it. Okay. Now, final three consonant clusters is in adopts. Ter, ther, ser, depths. Ter, ther, ser, eight facts. All these words have got three consonant clusters in the final position. I hope you understood it. Do I need to explain?
No.
Now moving on, consonant cluster. Then we have, clusters represent the suffixes. Sir, sir, sir. Look at the words. NDS, bands, bulbs, wells, realms, kins, and shells. All has got Z as the S form. Because past suffix, this is what I told you earlier. If T is the last consonant in the clusters listed above, which is usually representing using present suffix ED, consonant cluster, NZ. Z comes when the word ends with a voiced sound. S comes when the word ends with a voiceless sound. Okay? So for example, cat. You use the plural cats. And similarly for dog, you use the plural form dogs. Both take S as the plural form. Am I right?
Yeah.
Yes. But in the case of cat, the word ends with ter sound, which is a voiceless sound. So we use ser sound. Then we get cats.
Okay.
But in the case of dog, it is a voiced sound, g. So you can't use ser sound. Then we use Z sound. So we pronounce it as dogs. Clear?
Yes.
So when a word ends with S, which is a spiral, how can you pronounce then two S's together? It's difficult. Then we use IZ as the pronunciation. For example, rose, hose. In all these words, the final consonant is S, which is a spiral. So you can't pronounce two S sounds in one stretch. So how would you pronounce it? We pronounce it as roses, hoses. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Just like this case, that is why it is written the last consonant in these clusters listed above, which usually represent the past suffix da. Da means they're all voiced sound. Da, ba, ma, na, va, they're all voiced sound. That is why we get Z as the pronunciation. So Z can represent the sound sir, sir. It means we usually add S to sir to denote plural. Apart from that, we also add sir to denote simple present tense, singular form of simple present tense. He reads books every day. Is that clear?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Moving on, consonant clusters. So these are all examples changed. Consonant cluster. Na, jada, changed. This is what I told you earlier. Again, look at the consonant clusters. Cleansed, changed, bulged, overwhelmed, solved. All these has got the ending the. Just because they all end with voiced sound. That is why we have got the sound as the past pronunciation. Clear? In all these words, the represent the past suffix the or ed. Because all these words end with voiced sound change. The is voiced. Clean. Again, clean. Cleanse. Again, the word ends with sir sound. Cleanse. So, sir is a voiced sound. Bulge. Again, is a voiced sound. The is a voiced sound. Overwhelm. Again, is a voiced sound. Solve. Again, ver is a voiced sound. So in order to show the past form of past and past participle forms of these words, we pronounce, we use the as a pronunciation. While okay. earlier we saw perta, ta. Is it clear? If the word ends with a voiced sound, the pronunciation will be the or id, I, the. If the word ends with a voiceless sound, the pronunciation will be t. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. This is all about it. Then consonant cluster exams. The is the final element in all these clusters listed below. Then final four consonant clusters. This is all very easy. You read it, you will understand. NPTS. There are four clusters. M, P, T, S. So it's a cluster of four consonant sounds. Then LKTS, miles, skulls. In all these words, we can see cluster of four consonant sounds. Clear? Shall I move on?
Yeah, ma'am.
Could you tell me the time?
Yes, ma'am.
5:45.
Let me see whether I can finish the block. Phonetic transcription. Again, that is what we are going to see. It's the representation of speech sounds using symbols. So we use International Phonetic Alphabet. That is the phonetic that shows the transcription. That is the reference, the transcription for reference. International Phonetic Alphabet. This is phonetic, International Phonetic Alphabet. IPA. E-E-U-U-A-A-A. So all this transcription has got, this table has got the transcription. All the symbols are included in the table. IPA. We follow IPA. International Phonetic Alphabet. That is an alphabet which is made as a point of reference, consists of all the symbols. Okay, clear? You just look at the consonant sounds. Pa, ba, ta, da, cha, ja, ka, ga, fa, va, ta, da, sa, za, sha, ra, ma, na, nga, ha, la, ra, va, ya. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
This is
IPA. J is ya or ja, ma'am?
It is ya. Even though the letter is ja, the pronunciation, the simple refers to the pronunciation ya. It is, don't pronounce it as ja. It is ya. Ja is which one?
D3
is for the sake of pronunciation, for the isness of understanding, I'll say it as D3. D3 is J.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Why? Year is J.
Okay, ma'am.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
I'll share the PPT, don't worry. I think this is all about it. Okay, we have come to the end of the block. Just wait.
Ma'am, would you please read the pronunciation of these words again?
Which words?
From P to J.
Sorry. P as in pen. B as in bus. T as in ten. D as in dog. Ch as in chin, chess, j as in juice, James, then k as in kin, cat. See, when you write cat, don't use c. If the transcription is k sound. So you use k as the symbol. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
K. Now onward, c is going to be k in phonetics. Next is g as in goat. Then f as in fan. Again, there is a difference between v and w, w. So I told you earlier that v is to be pronounced with v. V is to be pronounced with v.
Yes.
Lower lip and teeth. So when you pronounce lower lip and when you touch, when your lower lip touches the upper of teeth, it is v. V as in van, v as in vehicle, v as in wine. Which wine?
V-I-N-E.
But when you say V-I-N-E means the creeper vine. So when you use W-I-N-E, it is wine with round lips. All those words.
As in water.
Water, when, why, where. So all those words which use V in the spelling will follow V as a pronunciation. Which V? The lower lip and teeth. Okay. Then in case of W, in there are certain words they won't use W, but still the pronunciation will be there. In all those words we use W. I'll show you the examples. So the, then we have the as in thin, thick. Thems, then we have the as in there, this, that. Then sir as in sun, z as in zoo, zebra. Then sh as in shame, share. Then j as in vision, pleasure, measure. Then m as in man, n as in name, ng as in sing, young, English, language. Then h as in house, l as in light, r as in rain, w as in water, when. Then y as in university, youth, young. All these words. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. I'll show you something from your textbook. See, phonetic transcription. Look at unit 3. Can you see this?
Yes, ma'am.
See, you can see a few words. Bow, B-O-U-G-H. We pronounce it as bow. Then, dow, B-O-U-G-H, dow. Oh, it is not ow, it is o. There is a different vowel being used. Then, through.
Through.
Then, how do you pronounce the fourth word?
Cough.
It is not cough. It is cough. It is cough. Don't pronounce it as cough. It is cough.
Cough.
Again, we use o. In the first one, bow, it is ow. In the second one, it is o. Then, through, oo. Then, fourth one, it is o. Cough. It is cough. O. Okay, cough, then thorough, it is just we have seen an inverted E sound. So we use there, thorough. Then it is tough, just simple R. See, four, there are six words, which we, all these words have something in common. The vowel combination O-U is common, but still they have different pronunciation, different vowel for the same vowel combination. Did you notice that? When the spelling is O-U-G-H, all the words have O-U-G-H a spelling, but still the pronunciation for each word is different. Because
yes,
they use different vowels. Ow, ow, o, then o, then a thorough a, then a. Then let's take the next set of words. Field, machine, sweet. It is not suit, it is sweet, sweet room. Then greed, people, these. Key, receive, treat. See, even though the spelling is different, even though the vowel combination is different, they all have got the same pronunciation.
Excuse me, ma'am. This eight number, these is last word is jaw.
These.
Not jaw. These, S.
T-H-E-S-C. It is these. Can't you see this? I think it's small, the letters are small.
Ma'am, you can zoom it, you can zoom on your keypad as you zoom in a picture.
Yes, yes.
How you enlarge a picture, you can just zoom on your keypad, the mouse pad.
If you have the textbook, I think you can open it. That is the third unit. I've opened it using another page. I don't know whether I'll be able to zoom it.
Just press control or plus. This control and then
clear now.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, field, machine, sweet. It is not suit, it is sweet. Then greed, people, these, key, receive, treat. This is from your textbook only. Field, all these words have different vowel combination but same pronunciation. In the earlier set of words, we have same spelling but different pronunciation. But here we have different spellings but same pronunciation. See, all these words are given for you to understand how important this phonetic transcription. the need for studying phonetic transcription. The next set of words, seen, again, we have different spelling, but same pronunciation. The spelling is different, but pronunciation is same.
Yes, ma'am.
Boy, boy, sight, sight, here, here. Then look at the last word, quality. This is what I told you. There are words whereby we don't use W in spelling, but we pronounce the sound W. But in that case, don't ever use V, but instead use W, the bilabial W. Not the labiodental V, but the bilabial W has to be used. Quality, quarter, queen, quench, question, quilt, square, squash, squirrel. Look at all these words. We use a W there. All these words use W. Don't do things of quality, quarter, queen. Queen is K comes first, then we have W, queen. Then we have the long vowel E, then in N, queen. That is how we read. In the spelling is Q-U-E-E-N. The pronunciation is queen. Similarly, question. Again, we have K, then W, question. Again, it is not cha, it is cha, cha, as in church. Cha, as in chess, question. Is it clear?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So these words are given for you to understand. You know, what all ways the spellings can come and what all ways the pronunciation may vary. Again, we have excellent, exclusive, excursion, excuse. Sorry. Did you say something? Did you say something? Hello?
No one said anything.
I will lose connection. Hello?
No, yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am, you haven't lost any connection.
We can carry on.
Sorry?
You can carry on, ma'am.
Okay, fine. So look at the first six words, 1 to 6. Excellent, exclusive, excursion, excuse, exercise, exhibition. So what is the pronunciation there? K and sir, right? K as in cane and sir as in sun. Excellent. K and sir is used. But look at the second set of words. Exact, examine, example, exertion. So in all those words, we have a different pronunciation for the same combination E and X. The first six words have the pronunciation K and sir, but the second set of pronunciation, second set of words, that is 7 to 10, has got the pronunciation G and Z. Examine. G and Z. Earlier words have the combination K and sir. Here we have the combination G and Z. Exact. Examine. Example. Exertion. Did you understand the difference even though the spelling is same? Excellent is E, K, sir. K and sir. But here, examine has got a different combination, vowel combination, that is G and Z. That means two voiced combination. Earlier we have seen two voiceless consonant combination. Not sir is not a voiceless voiceless sound. It's a voiceless sound, but still voiced and voiceless combination. But in the second set of words, we have two voiced set of combination, voiced consonant combination. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we study today?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it enough for the day?
Yes, ma'am.
I finished the I have finished one block. We'll continue the next block. That is, there are two parts to phonetics, part one and part two. We have finished the first block. There is one more module. There is one more block, which is part of this, that we will discuss on Saturday, Sunday. I hope these ideas are clear to you.
Yes, ma'am.
When you
studied
phonetics earlier, but there are some students who haven't yet studied this phonetics, please, they may at least ask if they have any doubts. Are these ideas clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Clear.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.